We're all taught how to live our lives and what it takes to be successful. But at the end of the day, what is it really all about? You have something special within you, something greater than yourself. Look beyond what's in front of you. Realize that you are put on this earth for a specific purpose. And in order to discover that, you have to start talking about it. And that starts now. Living Authentically with Gina Mazzetti.
Thank you for joining us today and welcome to the sixth episode of Living Authentically. To get us started, let's begin by taking a few steps back and traveling to the past. When you were little and people would ask, what do you want to be when you grow up? Or perhaps you'd hear your family members, teachers, or mentors say, I wonder what she will amount to. Or imagine who he will become. This is all too common, as so many of us have overheard this conversation or may have been asked this very question. What do you want to do? Where do you see yourself in 5 years from now? What's your end goal? You may perceive such inquiry to be rather overwhelming, whether the wave of overwhelm stems from feeling uncertain, scared, or just unsure. What's important to recognize here is the two profound components each of us have in common, a purpose and a choice to fulfill it or not. As we go through life, we encounter love, strive to create impact, and pay the bills. Often, we get so caught up in working our 9-to-5 or making sure we make ends meet that we forget the sole reason we are put on this earth, to do what we love and provide the world a gift that only you can give. Because no one can be you the way you can. Look at your purpose as a magnet drawn to you, regardless of what you do in life, no matter how many opportunities come up, it is your job and responsibility to exercise and employ it. This isn't always easy, and that's why many ignore it and leave it to the side. On today's show, I'm thrilled to have brought back Dr. Jennifer Contreras, who will discuss her journey to authenticity, the good times, the bad, and the moments her purpose kept knocking on her door time after time. Jennifer will exemplify how one can align themselves to their passion and make their purpose a top-tier priority in life by unpacking her road to authenticity. So when we come back, prepare to be enlightened by a mother who has not only advocated for her child, however, has been a champion for those with intellectual and physical disabilities. This is going to be good. Stay tuned.
Brought to you by Mazzetti's Bakery, located at 101 Manor Drive in Pacifica. Their phone number is 650-355-1007. That's 650-355-1007. Their website is www.mazzettisbakery.com. Mazzetti's Bakery, a proud sponsor of Living Authentically with Gina Mazzetti.
Welcome back to Living Authentically. We are back with my guest, Dr. Jennifer Contreras, who will now share her road to authenticity. Jennifer, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me on the show, Gina.
Oh, of course, we are so glad to have you back. So let's start there. Tell us about your journey to authenticity.
Well, it all started when my son was diagnosed when he was 4 years old. He was diagnosed with developmental disability.
Okay.
Global developmental delays really was the diagnosis. And so I asked the doctors what that meant, and they said, well, we have to continue to watch him and observe him, but what he'll need right now is some speech therapy, occupational therapy, and physical therapy because he had been missing his milestones. He had been missing his age milestones that the pediatricians say that they should have. So for example, he didn't walk until he was 20 months old, and most kids walk when they're 12 months old.
Gotcha.
So, you know, at that time I thought, okay, well, he's developmentally delayed. We can fix that through therapy, and that's what I tried to do with my son. I tried to fix him. When the doctor said that he should take karate class and he should maybe even take swimming class, one or the other, perhaps twice a week. I made sure he was in swimming class 3 times a week and took karate 3 times a week. When they said he needed speech therapy, perhaps 30 minutes twice a week, he was in speech therapy for 1 hour 3 times a week.
So he was busy.
I made sure he got all the intervention that was needed because I thought, well, if he's delayed, all that means is that he'll catch up if he just works hard, which is something that I've always done. I haven't been the smartest person ever in school or you know, the brightest person at work. But with hard work, I could catch up to others and even exceed them. And so I just thought, well, my son just needs to work harder. And as time went on, we realized that his intellectual capacity just wasn't the same as other children. When he was 9 years old, he was diagnosed with what was called at the time mental retardation, now known as intellectual and developmental disability. And so when that happened, you know, I wasn't surprised. I only have one son, and his dad and I discussed how we would raise him and what we would do, and we just wanted to encourage him to be the best that he could be. But in this journey, I was frustrated because I tried to get Antonio into a Christian school. In fact, the Christian school that I attended when I was in elementary. I wanted Antonio to be raised not just by his parents, us, in his faith, but I also wanted him to be surrounded with that at school. And so when I went to the school that I attended from kindergarten through 8th grade, the superintendent said to me that they didn't have the right expertise or services for him and that he would be better off in public school. And I just found that to be very surprising. As the year went on, Antonio was rejected from 23 Christian schools.
23 schools rejected.
In the Bay Area. Within 40 miles, a 40-mile radius of our house.
Wow.
So I was, you know, when I went to the first few schools, I understood that perhaps they didn't have the teachers to teach him or the therapists at the school. I think I was a little bit naive, though. I just assumed that there would be those resources, that we had progressed so that those resources would be there to help my son.
How did that rejection feel, though? 23 times.
23 times, and I counted, and it was each time a school rejected us, I just felt more and more sad, and then I became more and more angry.
So you were very discouraged.
I was extremely discouraged. And so as time went on, I just thought, I did find a really great school, originally in Burlingame and now in Palo Alto. It's called Hope Technology School.
Okay.
And that school, it wasn't a Christian school per se, but it was a private school, and they practiced this method, this approach to learning called full inclusion. So they had classrooms that were no more than 12 children, and they also had at least 3, I think maybe 4 children that may have some sort of special needs, whether it was intellectual disability or it could have been autism, someone on the autism spectrum. But they did have children, and they had the rest of the children were what we call typically abled children. And so it was a wonderful school for Antonio. There was on-site physical therapy, speech therapy, occupational therapy. So he got everything he needed from the age of 5 to about 9. And then when he was 9, the school was pretty expensive, but it was a terrific school for him. We thought that he was equipped to then go to public school, go to a place that was closer to our home.
Okay.
And at the time, I still checked in with other schools of faith, whether they were Catholic schools or Christian schools, and still there was no school in the Bay Area that could take him. So just to explain intellectual disability, Antonio is very social. He is normal by most standards. He plays basketball. He loves video games. He can't really understand things in the abstract. He's very concrete.
Okay.
And so he needs a little bit of extra time and a little bit of extra help to understand things that his peers would normally understand.
So he receives certain kind of accommodations.
Exactly. Okay. Exactly. So in public school, he received some accommodations. But I was still upset. There was something gnawing at me. That there was something wrong with the fact that private schools, especially schools of faith,
oh, of course,
that they could not accommodate Antonio. And so at the time, I was working in corporate America. I was working 60, 70 hours a week. I didn't have time to necessarily go and fight the system or argue the system, the private school system. What I did was I just did the best I could for my son and got him some tutoring outside of school. And I would get him additional speech therapy and additional occupational therapy to help him. And then I ended up working in academia. I was the associate dean for the University of San Francisco Business School.
Okay.
And I was asked to get a doctorate degree in order to continue my career in academia, just because if you are an associate dean or if you're a high-level person in academia, most of them have doctorate degrees.
Okay.
And so I went to the School of Education and decided to do a doctorate program in leadership studies. And when I was talking to my advisor about what I wanted to do and what I wanted to research and write about, I knew I wanted to do something about women of color in leadership positions, because this was something that was very prevalent in my career, something that I experienced, and there were aspects to that leadership style that I wanted to explore more.
And you discussed that the last time you were on the show.
I did, yes. And when I talked to my advisor about this, and she and I are very good friends, her name is Dr. Ellen Herta, she's a wonderful woman, she said that every time I talked about it, I would just get angry and frustrated about you know, women of color in leadership positions, just because I had experienced a lot of, you know, I would say discrimination in the corporate workforce. However, when I talked about my son and talked about his condition and talked about everything that was terrific about him, about how he loves people and he was very social and he loved sports and he loved video games, and this dilemma of not being able to put him in a Christian private school, she said that it was more interesting to hear that from me. And not only was I passionate about it, but she could feel that I wanted to do something about it.
It was a more positive approach coming from you.
It was. Because even though I was angry and frustrated and very sad that I couldn't put him in a Christian private school, inside of me I thought to myself, you know, what is stopping schools from being able to do this? Because it didn't seem to be consistent with faith. And being able to love everyone and accept people. So she suggested that I do research on Christian schools throughout the country that had programs for kids with special needs. And I thought to myself, there aren't any programs like that, because I've checked the Bay Area. We live in one of the most educated, wealthy parts of the country. And if we haven't figured it out, you know, because I thought that something like that would just take a lot of money.
Right.
Like, we just need a lot of money. And she said, well, that's why I want you to do the research. So why don't you go ahead and research leaders in Christian schools that actually have programs? So I went into it skeptical, thinking that I wasn't going to really find any schools that did this in the country. And when I started looking, and it was like finding a needle in a haystack, I looked at probably over 1,000 schools that were listed on the Association of Christian Schools website. I was surprised to find that there were schools out there, but they weren't in Northern California.
Was that disappointing, or did you suddenly have hope because there were schools out like there?
I had hope that there were schools out there. And so there were schools with different models.
Okay.
So I found Christian schools that were private Christian schools that had a lot of money, that were high tuition schools locally, and they had accommodations for kids with dyslexia or with ADHD. Hmm. So learning disorders, not what's considered a disability.
So there was a limit there?
There was a limit.
Okay.
And then I found other schools. I found one school actually in Chicago where it was a Christian school, but it was only for children with severe disabilities. Hmm. So there weren't any, there wasn't a lot of day-to-day interaction with people of typical abilities.
Gotcha.
And then I found schools that had a school within a school. I found one in Southern California, and it was a Christian school with typical children, but there was a classroom or two classrooms for kids with different abilities or disabilities, whether it was autism or developmental disability or cerebral palsy or Down syndrome. But those classrooms, again, even though they were integrated on campus, they were not integrated academically. Mm. They didn't practice the inclusion approach that I had seen at Hope Technology School.
Okay.
And that's really what I was looking for. And then I went to Michigan, Western Michigan in Grand Rapids, Michigan, and I came across an organization called the CLC Network. It stands for Christian Learning Center Network. And was surprised and just ecstatic to find that they had over 40 Christian schools in that general vicinity.
Wow.
That had inclusion, full inclusion programs. 40 schools. And I thought to myself, why Western Michigan? And I was really interested. And I visited 6 schools there and found that it was really, it was an anchor in their faith. That they believed that all children were equal and that all children deserved a Christian education.
They really walked the talk then for their beliefs.
They really did. And that was key because they had a belief system, Christianity, but they really actually lived it out. And unfortunately, I haven't found that in terms of being a concentrated area, especially in a school. I didn't find that in any other part of the country.
Did you eventually find it? What happened from there?
So from there, I finished my dissertation. I wrote about the schools that I observed. I had talked to leaders of 17 schools and 11 made it into my dissertation. And after I wrote my dissertation, I thought to myself, there's got to be a way to bring that inclusive environment to a Christian school. Christian schools did not want to, it's not that they didn't want to have kids with disabilities in their school. I think that most people are informed these days that, you know, 1 in less than 100 kids are on the autism spectrum.
Right.
That there are many kids with different abilities, that school, the way that we have it, isn't the right approach for every child. So I think we're more informed. Really, Christian schools, because they're tuition dependent and not publicly funded, don't have the resources, and their teachers may not have the expertise, the special education expertise that is required in a public school. So those were the two things that prevented, you know, schools from having an inclusive program. So I wrote my dissertation and I thought, how can I start inclusive programs here? How can the Christian Learning Center, the CLC network in Michigan, take their, because they're a consultancy firm now, how can we take their expertise and how can we take the examples of over 40 schools in that Michigan, Wisconsin area? How can we take it to the Bay Area? How can we take it everywhere throughout the country or everywhere throughout the world? And so fast forward a few years, I had really given up. Antonio then was in a local public school. He had been segregated in the public school. Out of 7 classes, the only classroom where he was integrated was in PE. And the rest of the day, he was in a separate classroom along with all the other kids with special needs.
So they were pushed to the side.
Well, it was a very restrictive environment. Public law says that they need to be put in the least restrictive environment. And he was put in a very restrictive environment. And so I even fought the public school system about his placement. And so it just so happened that I went to church that Antonio attends with his youth group, and I attended for Easter, and I was talking to the pastor's wife, and she at brunch, and I had given up. I had thought, you know, Antonio will never be able to go to a school of faith. And she told me, well, you know, you should talk to the headmaster of the school because I think there are some kids with learning disabilities. And so I was still skeptical, but I thought, why not? This school is 2 miles away from my home. I might as well give it a shot.
Why not try it out?
Why not try it out? Why not make an appointment? So I made an appointment with the headmaster for Alma Heights. His name is Dave Gross. And interestingly enough, he was actually completing his dissertation. And when we talked, or doing the research for his dissertation, when we talked, he wanted to read my dissertation. And I told him that I really wanted to see an inclusive environment. He read parts of my dissertation, called me and said, I feel compelled to have Antonio come to this school. We'll make it work.
Awesome.
So long story short, this past school year, 2014-2015, was the first year that Antonio attended, and he's a sophomore now. He was able to attend the school.
Good for him.
And there are other children that they've actually admitted that have special needs. Now, it's not perfect. They don't have all of the expertise or all of the resources, but they had the heart to do so. And we need not just finances, but we also need the heart and, you know, the ethical aim to do the right thing inside of us. So that was just an enormous, not just a relief, but just enormously excited that I saw a Christian school do the right thing. And I, of course, helped with funding of this, and my company is matching because it is a school, it is an educational system, and I'm also working with helping the school raise additional funds so that other kids with special needs can attend. Also, there's another school in the South Bay that came to observe Alma Heights just a few weeks ago, and they are looking at starting their beta program.
Great.
This upcoming school year. So 2015-2016, they should be starting. So hopefully this will spread. This isn't my full-time job. I do have a day job, but I am an inclusion advocate, and this is an area that I have expertise in. And, you know, after years, 10 years, this was 10 years in the making. It was 10 years from the time that Antonio was rejected from his first of 23 schools.
Now, can you touch on Best Buddies? I know you're doing a lot of other work as well, the documentary, the book. Can you touch a little bit on that as well?
Absolutely. So we'll start with the documentary and book. So the book that I'm writing is about my experience, my journey from having Antonio diagnosed to the frustration of not being able to put him in a Christian school, and then now the implementation.
Okay.
And a documentary will actually follow. So I'll start off with a trailer. And then as the program continues to be implemented, and as Antonio, not just he learns in that environment, but as he teaches others patience, kindness, compassion, just from being present in the school. And these are all things, again, that are tenets of the Christian faith.
Of course.
That people should be practicing, but many times don't. Inclusion, acceptance. As Antonio teaches others, you know, I'm hoping that that is what is displayed in not just the book, but also the documentary.
Well, Jennifer, thank you so much for all the work you're doing. You're helping so many different people out. And it's really inspired people at home as well, just to do what they're passionate about and really make it their life's work. So thank you for unpacking your journey. And if your school is interested in launching an inclusion program, please contact Jennifer. So when we come back, I will be here to discuss all that we learned today. But until then, here's a clip of Jennifer interviewing Tim Shriver.
My question to you is, talk more, you alluded to this earlier, but tell me more about what we learn from people with intellectual disability. What do we gain from that? Because I think that when many people look at things like the Special Olympics as I'm going to help and volunteer with the Special Olympics, mm-hmm. or even with my son going to school, you know, this is an opportunity for us to help him. And I'm coming from the angle of my son can help the students here develop more compassion, mm-hmm. et cetera. So can you elaborate more on what we learn from people that have that difference?
Well, I think the first message is there is no us and them.
Right.
There is only us. Mm-hmm. It's the fundamental message of all religions. It's the fundamental truth that lies at the heart, in my view, of the human soul. There is no us and them. We have constructed a world in which we put a lot of people into categories, and we use those categories to exclude people. We use categories to push them either out of our circle or to invite them in, and those models invariably carry with them enormous pain, both for the excluder and for the excluded. The Special Olympics world view, and you can't write this down, you have to experience it, and most people who do experience it come away, I believe, understanding it, is that we end us and them. You can cross into a gym, really just open that steel door and walk into a gym where a Special Olympics event is taking place, and you can almost feel it. It's almost as though, in the biblical sense, you were surrounded by or open to a light or a wind that blows differently. There is no judgment in this world. There is challenge, there is hope, there is delight, there is competition, but there's no judgment. There is no excluding. There is no finger pointing. There is no blame. There is no pity.
Brought to you by Mazzetti's Bakery, located at 101 Manor Drive in Pacifica. Their phone number is 650-355-1007. That's 650-355-1007. Their website is www.mazzettisbakery.com. Mazzetti's Bakery, a proud sponsor of Living Authentically with Gina Mazzetti.
Welcome back to Living Authentically. Today has been an inspiring show, as Jennifer has showcased the value in going after one's purpose and exemplified the ability to hit rock bottom and bounce right back up as she was on the edge of leaving her faith behind and soon was given a golden ticket to sending her son to school. Not only did Antonio earn a seat in the classroom, so did hundreds of students with disabilities, or what Jennifer likes to call different abilities. Jennifer has shown us the power of having an idea, applying that very thought, and scaling it out to her life's work, as she is writing a book, producing a documentary, and opening more spaces for inclusion programs. I now would like to turn this to you and send a friendly reminder encouraging you that although knowledge is power, one must apply their thought, their big idea, or plan and put it into use, not only to fulfill their own lives, but to impact, better, and strengthen the lives of so many others, just as Jennifer has and will continue to do so. With that said, I'd like to end with an exercise. Think back to the answer you gave your teacher who asked you what you wanted to be when you grew up, and ask yourself if you followed through, went after your desire, or perhaps did something about it. Maybe you told your teacher, "I want to make people happy." Ask yourself what you can do every day to accomplish that. You might plan on surprising someone at work with flowers, or maybe you will visit a senior center and socialize with the elderly. Or maybe you'll send your teacher a thank you note for reminding you that you have some personal work to do. Not because you watch this program, but to live a life of authenticity. I'm Gina Mazzetti, and I'll see you next time. Well, don't